बिस्मिल्लाह रहमान रहीम। टुडे इज़ माई टॉपिक इज़ डिस्ट्रैक्शन ऑस्टियोजेनेसिस इन ऑर्थोडोंटिक्स। डिस्ट्रैक्शन ऑस्टियोजेनेसिस इज़ बेसिकली द मैनिपुलेशन ऑफ द हीलिंग। इन 1997 डॉक्टर पॉल टिसे रेफर्ड द डिस्ट्रैक्शन ऑस्टियोजेनेसिस एज द एंड ऑफ फेशियल ऑस्टियोटमीज एज वी नो दैम। न्यू इनोवेशन टू इम्प्रूव पेशेंट केयर आर हाईली अट्रैक्टिव एंड इम्पोर्टेंट। हाउएवर द यूज़ ऑफ डिस्ट्रैक्शन ऑस्टियोजेनेसिस फ्रीक्वेंटली एक्सीड्स एंड प्रीसीड्स इज साइंटिफिक इवेल्युएशन। Following the first successful dissection of the mandible, the application of the treatment concept has developed rapidly. Numerous ingenious applications ranging from the increase of alveolar bone height for dental implant placement and increase in maxillary and mandibular dental arch width to the transfer of the bone in reconstruction following jaw disc resection have been developed. A multitude of dissection devices ranging from large extraoral appliances, minute intraoral devices, multi-vector devices, and even resorbable devices for neonates have been designed and developed. A major advantage of dissection osteogenesis is that it provides solution for the correction of severe and previously untreatable deficiencies of the craniofacial region. Dissection is advantageous because the surgeon can achieve large skeletal movements. In addition, dissection of soft tissues makes it an impressive and dynamic treatment modality that has become an essential part of the orthognathic surgeon's armamentarium. Several basic treatment principles for successful dissection of bone as initially described by Lizarov, including osteotomy of the bony cortex with minimal periosteal stripping. Depending on the surgical site, a latency period ranging from 3 to 7 days is necessary before activation of the dissection device. In young children, the latency period should be shorter. The rate of dissection should be 0.5 to 2 mm per day. This rate is influenced by the surgical site and the age of the patient. In neonates, the dissection rate should be faster to prevent early ossification. Application of a continuous force is ideal. However, activation of the dissection device twice or thrice times a day is practical. Following dissection, a period of stabilization for consolidation of the bone regenerate is essential. The consolidation period depends on the magnitude of the dissection, the type of deformity, the age of the patient. In adults, the consolidation period should be at least 3 months. In children, a shorter period may be indicated. Once consolidation has been confirmed radiographically, the dissection device can be removed. Although orthopedic surgeons can correct angular and rotational long bone deformities with dissection, the basic shape of the long bone is cylindric, and it is easy to place these dissectors on long bones. But in the facial region, the three-dimensional curvature of the facial skeleton, variation in bone thickness, the extreme accuracy demanded by the occlusion, the sensitivity of the TMJs and importance of facial aesthetics are all factors adding to the difficulty of the technique. Another challenging aspect of placement of dissector in the facial region is to make the appliance as unobtrusive as possible. The treatment technique and protocol as described by Lizarov had to be adjusted and refined for the application to the facial bones. Successful dissection demands accurate pre-surgical planning that often requires three-dimensional models. It is critical to determine the correct vector for lengthening, accurate positioning of the device on the bone, the size and design of the device, and the positioning of the driver for easy activation. Stereolithic models are often used to determine the best site for placement while allowing the surgeon to pre-bend the device. The pre-surgical adjustment of the device to conform to the anatomy of the bone saves considerable operating time. Now comes to the treatment phases. The following proper treatment planning, dissection osteogenesis can be divided into 5 treatment phases. These are the number 1 is the surgical phase. In the surgical phase, a minimum amount of periosteum should be dissected from the bone for placement of the dissection device. The device is first positioned and fixed to the bone according to the treatment plan. The osteotomy line is then accurately marked and the device removed. The osteotomy is then performed through the cortex of the bone, taking care not to damage any underlying structures such as the tooth roots, nerves, and bone vessels. Complete the osteotomy through the cancellous bone and carefully test the mobility of the bone segments. The dissection device is replaced and fixed. It is critical that the functionality of the device is now tested by activating the driver, ensuring movements of the segments and at the same time taking care not to injure underlying structures. Now comes to the second phase, that is the latency period. Once the cortical osteotomy osteotomies have been completed and the distraction device placed, a latent period is required to allow for resolution of the initial inflammatory response. The initial healing phase involves organization of the hematoma, while mesenchymal endosteal and periosteal cells are induced into osteoblasts and fibroblasts. Osteoid is produced following deposition of type 1 collagen. Third stage is the distraction phase. The initial process of bone formation involves a regenerate chamber filled with a fibromatrix that will ossify starting at the periphery and moving centrally over time. The fibrous matrix is lengthened by distraction and can occur at a rate of 1 mm per day. In children younger than 6 years, the rate may be increased. If the distraction is performed too fast, non-union will result. On the other hand, distraction performed too slow may result in early bone healing and failure of bone lengthening. Fourth one is the consolidation phase. Once the required bone length has been obtained, the bone segments need to be stabilized to allow for the regenerate to consolidate into mature bone. The consolidation time in adults should be at least 12 weeks depending on the magnitude of distraction, anatomy of the bone, type of deformity, and age of the patient. An adequate length of consolidation time and stabilization of the bone segments are essential during this phase and will influence the stability of the results. Now comes the fifth phase, that is the removal of the distraction device. Confirmation of ossification of the bone is done by the basic radiography or other imaging modalities such as computed tomography. In most patients, removal of the distraction device is tedious and cumbersome, necessitating a second surgical procedure. A major advantage of resorbable devices is that in most instances, the device does not require removal. Currently, the use of resorbable devices is indicated only in neonates. Distraction osteogenesis offers several advantages over conventional orthognathic surgical techniques. Like large advances can be achieved, the surrounding soft tissue matrix is also expanded, the need for bone grafting is limited or eliminated, and it is thought that the potential for relapse is less than with the traditional treatment methods. Despite these advantages over conventional orthognathic surgery, the following disadvantages should be kept in mind when choosing a treatment technique during treatment planning. These factors are very important, and these are: number one, risk of premature bone formation resulting in failure of bone lengthening. Second is the risk of distracting too fast resulting in non-union. Third is higher rate of post-operative infection. Four is the risk of distraction device failure. Five is difficulty of vector control resulting in inaccurate segment positioning. Six is removal of the distraction device requiring a second surgical procedure. Seventh is patient discomfort during distraction. 8th is lack of patient compliance regarding activation of the distraction device. 9 is severe scars caused by mandibular extraoral devices. And 10th is additional expense related to the cost of the distractors and the need for a second procedure for removal of the device. Now, what procedures can be done? Number one is the mandibular lengthening by distraction osteogenesis. The complex three-dimensional anatomy of the mandible and bilateral involvement of the TMJs render distraction of the mandible challenging. Precise pre-surgical planning and accurate device orientation is paramount for predictable widening and lengthening of the mandible. The device should be placed parallel to the axis of the distraction. In patients requiring bilateral distraction, the vectors of the devices should be parallel to each other. Because the mandible is narrow in the front and wider at the back, adjustment should be made by creating a step to compensate for the discrepancy in width of the anterior and posterior mandible. Failure to compensate for the variation in mandibular body width may result in loosening of the screws, bending of the device, development of a torque force on the condyles, and failure of distraction. So these are very important factors. Now comes to the TMJ consideration. Once the distractor is activated, reciprocal forces are placed on the glenoid fossa by the condyle. Flattening of the condyle, thinning and even perforation of the cartilaginous disc, subcondylar bone formation, and loss of the superior and inferior joint space have been reported. Some clinicians think that it is fundamental to unload the joints before distraction. It is recommended that during the pre-surgical orthodontic phase, the joint should be unloaded by a class 2 elastics, 6 ounces per side. The unloading forces are continued during the distraction and consolidation phases and later discontinued by the orthodontist. An open bite may develop during the distraction phase as a result of lack of parallelism or poor vector control of the devices. Open bite may be overcome by releasing the anteroposterior arm of the device following full activation. The bite is then closed by placement of strong maxillomandibular elastic stator maintained during the consolidation phase. Now comes the post-surgical orthodontics. Once the distraction devices are removed, the patient is again referred to the orthodontist to finalize the occlusion. Some clinicians recommend the use of class 2 elastics during the distraction and consolidation phases. The long-term effects of this action on the TMJS have not yet been established. There are two main indications for distraction of the mandible. Number one, in young children with severe mandible deficiency, where conventional orthognathic surgery cannot be performed. And number two, in adult patients with abnormally shaped mandibles requiring large advancements. Second indication of distraction osteogenesis is maxillary advancement by distraction osteogenesis. Mid-phase deficiencies are traditionally treated by surgical advancement of the maxilla in the Lefort 1, 2 or 3 levels. Severe hypoplasia of the maxilla often occurs in syndromic patients and or patients with cleft lip and palate. The maxillary skeletal hypoplasia in patients with cleft lip and palate is usually a manifestation of impaired growth as a result of multiple previous surgeries and related scar tissue formation. These patients often require large advancements of the maxilla with bone grafting and extensive rigid fixation, but post-operative stability proves to be questionable. Anterior distraction of the maxilla should be considered as the preferred method of treatment in patients with obstructive sleep apnea. The distraction technique has the added advantage of monitoring the improvement of the posterior pharyngeal airflow and allowing titration of the advancement during the distraction phase. Intraoral devices can be used for distraction of the maxilla on the modified Lefort 1 and modified Lefort 3 levels. Extraoral distraction of the craniofacial region. For distraction of the mid-face at the Lefort 1 level, an extraoral device should be considered. However, it is very difficult to control the occlusion and simultaneously achieve optimal aesthetics in these patients. Widening of the maxilla by the distraction osteogenesis. It is relatively easy to widen the maxilla by opening the mid-palatal suture before or during the adolescence, but this procedure becomes increasingly difficult as the patient becomes older. Orthodontic expansion of the maxillary dental arch in adults is limited to dental movements and often involves tipping of the teeth. Orthodontic expansion of the teeth beyond the alveolar bone base will likely lead to transverse relapse. Skeletal constriction of the maxilla rarely occurs without coexisting vertical and or sagittal problems. Surgical expansion of the maxilla in patients with this condition can be easily accomplished by means of segmental surgery in the course of a Lefort 1 down fracture to correct other problems. When skeletal expansion of the maxilla is the main objective, distraction should be considered. Increase of the skeletal width of the maxilla by distraction is also called surgical assisted rapid palatal expansion or SARP, a form of rapid palatal expansion in adult patient whose midline palatal suture has ossified and been surgically recreated by a palatal osteotomy. Surgical assisted expansion of the maxilla is indicated in the following cases. Number one, when there are no other indications for the maxilla to be down fractured on the Lefort 1 level, such as advancement or superior repositioning. Second is when only unilateral expansion is required. Third is when an increase in arch length is required to accommodate all the teeth, that is the first molar had been removed, and the orthodontic encouraged loss resulted in loss of extraction space and severe crowding. Fourth is when space needs to be created for unerupted teeth in preparation for orthodontic treatment. Five is when a transverse increase of more than 7 mm is required, and sixth is when for patients whose previous orthodontic palatal expansion failed. The art of repositioning and lengthening these facial bones by distraction has slowly found its place in the field of surgical reconstruction of the face and has proved to be a powerful treatment modality. Continued research, critical evaluation of outcomes and technical refinements will certainly improve both the decision-making process of surgeons and patient treatment outcomes. Thanks.